And I am up. Starting the intro music, and let's get this show started.
I just got a message from Xbox, too.
You've gotten a free 1 month live subscription.
Sweet. We're doing more of that?
Nah. They gave me 2 months.
That's pretty cool. I'm all for free stuff.
Overdog, the first intense based matchmaking server for Xbox. Yeah. Nothing that intrigues me. I hate the first part, getting sick, get the sniffles.
Yeah.
And then the watery eyes. Thank you, human body. Get sick.
Yeah, I woke up this morning with a rather stiff neck. I hate it when that happens. Then your neck's sore all day.
I was fine yesterday, and I just wake up and it's fucking sniffles.
It happens.
I think I got too cold last night.
You leave your window open or something?
No, I have a fan going for background noise.
And we're live. All right, how you guys doing?
Pretty good.
Okay. hey there, everyone, and welcome to Nerd Nation, where we scour the internet for the latest gaming, tech, entertainment, and science news so you don't have to, while also offering occasional reviews. I'm Hanyu, and AP's sick today, but Ash and Bearded One are still here. Say hello.
Hello. Hi, guys.
I don't wanna.
I'm Ashley Archaic. You guys should already know that by now. I have a YouTube gaming channel, so go check that out. It's right there, Ashley Archaic. I do Let's Plays, occasional reviews, versus, and the occasional Twitches as well, just whatever game I have at the moment.
Zach has my introduction.
Yeah, I'm Hanyu. Most of you guys already know me. And yes, that's Bearded One, also known as Beardy, as I refer to him most of the time on my channel. Me and him team up usually for my Grand Theft GTA Online Presents series, but most recently I've restarted one of the fan favorite series, Legendcraft, which is a modded Minecraft Let's Play. So check both of them out on my channel, and yeah, let's jump right in with our dedication for this episode, which is Harrison Ford.
Yes.
He done crashed it in a plane.
That's not to say he's a bad pilot. Most people actually say he's actually a terrific pilot, which actually goes
If you've seen Star Wars, he's a pretty excellent pilot.
Credit where credit's due, he crash landed the plane that he was flying in a rather heavily populated area by landing it on a golf course, so he was able to steer it away from basically taking down one or multiple people's homes, so.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But he was able to walk away from it. He was labeled as critical condition for a while, but since then he has been moved to stable condition, and he's expected to make a full recovery.
Yeah, Han Solo can't die yet.
Not yet. We just lost Leonard Nimoy last week, losing. I'll admit, when I first read that Harrison Ford was in a plane crash, I'm like, oh shit, really? We just lost Leonard Nimoy. Don't tell me we're gonna lose Harrison Ford too.
No.
My heart sank when I saw that. I'm like, oh, thank God, he's okay.
I heard it on the radio on my way home. I was like, oh, shit. And then they said, oh, he's in stable or critical but stable condition. I'm like, okay, good.
Yeah. And Keep in mind, I said this after I found out he was okay, but the plane he crashed is a vintage World War II plane, and I'm like, that kind of sucks about the plane. Because those things are they're collector's items, you know? They're part of history.
They're like, what, 100 years old now?
Not yet.
80?
They're getting up there, yeah. 40s, so.
So about 80-something years?
And in about an extra five to 7 years, I believe. It'll be the 100th anniversary of... No, wait, the 80th anniversary of World War II. The beginning of World War II, I think.
He thinks.
History ain't my thing. I know basics, but
yeah, same here. I'm like, I'm out of this one. Sorry, guys.
All right, so thankfully Harrison Ford's okay.
Yeah,
that's the gist of what that's what we're getting at. All right.
So jumping in. Throne Wars Simulator Crowfall raises 800,000 in 3 days.
Yeah, we've been talking a little bit about Kickstarter and stuff lately, so it seemed a bit of a no-brainer to bring something like this up.
Yeah, I mean, that's a lot of money in 3 days.
It's an MMO by a veteran of the genre. The developers worked on Ultima Online, Star Wars Galaxies, Wizards 101, and Star Wars The Old Republic.
Woohoo!
So, while Galaxies was a bit of a flop, I mean, it was a good game, but it didn't really live up to most Star Wars fans' expectations. The Old Republic was a really good game.
Yeah.
But, so, these guys... but, yeah, I mean, these guys know what they're doing, is what we're getting at. So while we did cover somebody scamming Kickstarters in a past episode, these guys know what they're doing, and this is pretty much a safe investment.
Good for them.
And at the time of the article posting, which was last week, it had reached $882,779. And as of let me bring up the page if I can find it. Oh, and apparently it's already passed $1 million.
Damn.
Oh.
So, since Friday, it's gained another $200,000.
Wow. Bravo.
It is now at $1,033,369. Pledged by 10,817 backers.
Wow.
So, people want to see this. People want to see this game. All right.
Let's just hope it comes out better on the other end.
Moving on to... I did bring up Leonard Nimoy already, didn't I?
You did.
Well, Star Trek Online is honoring Leonard Nimoy with an in-game memorial.
Oh, that's pretty
cool. So, yeah, apparently there's a memorial built to Spock now in... Star Trek Online.
Pretty cool.
Because, let's face it, Star Trek... Spock's a big part of it.
Yeah.
I mean, a really, really big part of it.
Yeah, I think if you bring up Star Trek, the first person anybody brings up is Spock.
That's the first person I think
Spock of. Spock or Kirk. Let's face it. Without William Shatner and Leonard Nimoy, Star Trek would not be as big as it is today.
No. Because all people would be talking about is Star Wars.
Yeah. So, yeah. I'm still a little broken up about the whole Leonard Nimoy dying thing, but...
Oh.
Can't live forever. Sad.
Not yet, anyway.
Yeah.
We're working on it.
We're working on it, but it's a shame he couldn't live a couple more decades. He'd probably be the first one that people would willingly give the Fountain of Youth pill just so that he could live longer.
Right.
Moving on, we have a bunch of news that came out of GDC this year, mainly around Valve, believe it or not.
Yeah, lots of VR news, virtual reality.
Virtual reality, Steam OS, possible hint at Half-Life 3 or Half-Life Episode 3.
Or virtual reality. That's a thing that they're trying to... A rumor's going around that's going to be for virtual reality, a Half-Life game.
Possibly.
Yeah. I mean... Just reinvent one of the older Half-Lives, able to use the head tracking and stuff like that. I mean, technically, these things could work with any first-person game because it's the whole interface is about first-person. So if they could adapt it to work with most first-person games, I mean, they're set, right?
It would seem so, but I mean, I'm sure there's so much more that goes into it. That...
Oh, I'm sure there is, too. All the programming to get the head tracking through, head tracking program working with the game program and stuff like that. But
yeah, exactly. So Valve, jumping in, they are they've got their own virtual reality headset, and it looks pretty cool. It's quite different than the ones that we've been seeing.
Yeah.
But I mean,
it's an interesting piece of tech, and it's made by HTC. I like HTC. It's a good brand. It's a brand I trust. And it's called the HTC Vive. And do we have specs for that? I'm not sure if we have specs for that yet.
I saw it somewhere. The headset itself sports, let's see, where is it? A pair of 1200 by 1080 displays that can handle video at 90 frames per second. So that's pretty fast if you guys
That is really good.
Yeah, and compared to the Oculus Rift that has a single 1080p panel and can refresh fast enough to support 75 frames per second, while the Gear VR has a 2560 by 1440 display, and it can only go as fast as 60 frames per second.
So I mean, when you think about it, do you need the 90 frames per second? Because it seems like a lot of games nowadays barely run at 60 frames per second.
I mean, I think it's a different look, so you probably have to like be hands-on with it to really tell.
Yeah, I'm definitely interested in it.
For sure.
And apparently, it's going the HTC Vive, Valve's VR headset is going to be available by the end of the year.
Yeah. So, we'll see how that goes. I tried the Oculus at E3 last year, and that alone by itself was incredible. So I can only imagine what this looks like.
Yeah.
So look forward to that.
I'd love to get my hands on an Oculus or something like that, or even this. I mean, just any of the VR headsets, except the Morpheus, mainly because I don't like how it looks.
It's not about the outside, it's about the inside.
Yeah, but...
But as mentioned earlier, HTC working to bring Half-Life to the virtual reality headset.
But then they said that they are not working with Valve on virtual reality Half-Life. because apparently they got misconstrued as people saying Half-Life 3 confirmed.
I could see that. They're just like, they threw it in there, but yeah, that needs some clarifying.
So, along with all this, Valve announced an update to its much-loved Source engine, Source 2, which is going to be very interesting. But hey, you know what? New engine means new games in that new engine. And, well, let's see. Let's count a bunch of stuff that was in the last Source engine. You had Half-Life 2, all the Half-Life 2 episodes. You had Portal 2. You had, Team Fortress 2, you had Left 4 Dead and Left 4 Dead 2. You had a bunch of really good-looking games in the original Source engine. Oh, and Counter-Strike, Global Offensive, and Counter-Strike 2, and stuff like that, so.
Yeah, definitely.
So a lot of really good-looking games came out of the first Source engine. So Source 2 has my seal of approval. Looking forward to that.
Valve also announced a Steam controller, the release and release date and price. It looks pretty nifty, futuristic looking.
I've been forgetting to post the links in my chat.
Shame on you.
Oops.
Here comes a whole big burst feed for you guys in chat.
Yeah, so when he gets that up, you guys should check out that link. It looks pretty cool. Let's see.
Any viewers yet?
Oh, we got a couple. We got a couple people chatting.
Who do we got?
We have Irish Curse, which is Steel.
Hello.
Freaky Freddy, Euphoric, Excelsior Pig One.
Hello, everyone.
So, where were we at? We were at the Steam controller, right?
Yeah, I'll announce it.
So Valve announced the Steam controller. The Steam Link, which lets you stream your PC games on your TV, and they also now, oh right, Steam OS and Steam consoles, all of which are set to release this November.
Nice.
I believe both devices are retailing around $50 USD.
For the Steam Link and the Steam controller?
Yeah.
Yeah, I believe so. But the Steam boxes, vary in price, ranging from anywhere between $450 all the way up to like $10,000.
Holy.
Well, when you think about it, all it is just a it's a computer built to be more like a console. So, of course, there's going to be varying levels of quality put into each of them.
Yep. Sounds good.
Because you're going to get stuff from like Falcon Northwest, which are the more high-end stuff, which their Steam OS boxes are already labeled as pricing between $5,000 and $10,000. But that's going to be the highest of the high end too. When you think about it, it's going to have the best processors, the best graphics cards, and all that other type of stuff, you know?
Yeah, for sure.
All right, moving on to the virtual reality controllers. What's your opinion on them?
I mean,
They kind of look like joysticks that aren't attached to anything.
they do. It just seems kind of like awkward because they're just two pieces of really big metal that you'd be moving around. So aesthetically, they're not pleasing. I don't really know how they feel and how they work, so it's hard to say. But aesthetically, they're not the prettiest thing I've ever seen. But I think that they're actually another upgrade's coming. so I don't think that's the final.
Yeah, I don't think that's the final thing either for them, but I mean, look at their controller. That went through multiple iterations before they finally settled on a design.
Yeah.
Because it used to be just the dual track pads and the
Right.
start and select button. Now it's got the dual track pads, one analog stick, and the A, B, X, Y buttons.
Yeah, so big improvements, for sure.
Let's see. Moving on from the Valve block, we go into more about gaming engines. So Unreal 4 is now free to everybody who wants to work with it.
That's nice.
I remember watching you play Unreal Tournament.
Well, there's actually mention of that later on, too.
But that's pretty cool. And then people who were paying for it, I guess they're getting refunds.
No, I think they get like the premier service or whatever. Everybody has a premier service now. If it's free, it's not actually free, or something like that. From what I understood, there's like a you can pay for a subscription to get to for better stuff. I don't know. Hold on, let me browse through this real quick because I remember saying that. For the, that there's they're doing something special for people who actually paid for it. Was previously publicly available for $19 a month, which will be free in return. Epic will take 5% off the game's gross revenue after the first $3,000 it generates each quarter. Previously only free for students, Unreal Engine 4's free download gives you access to the engine's entire tool set, the Unreal Engine marketplace, and 100% of the C++ source code. In addition, anyone who has paid for an Unreal 4 subscription will get $30 to be spent in the Unreal Engine marketplace.
Okay.
So
I understand.
it's kind of like what Microsoft's doing with Project Spark, basically. I'm not sure if any of you guys have played around with that.
I tried to, but it was just too much.
Yeah. I tried it as well, and I was just like, no, sorry.
But yeah, you can it, most all the basic stuff's free, but then you can get packs that are made by other people and like use it in your game or content and stuff like that. And,
Sure.
yeah. And then the other engine that was shown off is Unity 5. Unity is mainly used in indie games like Slender, and a couple others. That name escapes me right now.
Promises better graphics, massively enhanced graphic capabilities, animation, physics, and more.
Ah, here we go. Unity Engine. Games built on the Unity Engine include Kerbal Space Program, Gone Home, Hearthstone, and Broforce. I recognize a couple of those names. That never play. Actually, I recognize all the names, but I've only played Hearthstone and Kerbal Space Program.
Sure. Yeah, so it should be exciting to see how those look and what people come out with.
Oh yeah. Moving on, more from GDC, but this time from NVIDIA. So I believe last week we mentioned that NVIDIA was teasing the future of gaming.
Yes.
Yeah. Bit of a letdown.
Well, they gotta hype it
Freaky
up, you
Freddy
know.
mentioned Rust and Stranded Deep as also being a Unity engine. So, but yeah, so Basically, what they announced is a new NVIDIA Shield. And instead of being a mobile platform like the original NVIDIA Shield, this is a Android-based gaming console, kind of like the Ouya. Anybody here remember the Ouya? No? Don't doubt you. Don't blame you. It was a console that was kickstarted a couple of years ago, and never really quite lived up to expectations. It launched with OS Jelly Bean, Android 4.1 Jelly Bean, quad-core processor, NVIDIA GPU, NVIDIA Tegra 3 processor, gigabyte of RAM, 8 to 10 gig storage, and stuff like that. And it was a bit of a letdown. It was basically something that was supposed to let you play Android games on your computer. I mean, who wouldn't want to play a game dev story on their their TV, right?
Well, I was like looking at this and thinking, like, I can see how it's a cool idea, but how many people, like, does it pay off? Does it actually, like, the making of this console really pay off?
Ouya was a bit of a flop. I'm not gonna lie. Most people will tell you the same. The only way I can see NVIDIA Shield succeeding is if they try to get people to expand on that, the Android games, you know?
Well, that's what they're trying to do. They're trying to, like, massively expand it. But even if you do, I don't know.
I mean, yes, it's going to be a cheaper alternative for people who don't want to buy an Xbox or a PlayStation or a Wii. But the games aren't probably going to be that good.
Yeah, no. I mean, it's like, I don't know. It's like saying, here, I have an apple and there's like apple-flavored candy. It's totally not the same thing. One is definitely worse. So, I don't know.
It depends on the apple.
I guess that's true. But we shall see.
And honestly, I'll take Jolly Rancher's apple anytime. Just yeah, saying. So-
They're all right.
Moving on to another thing that they announced, which is their Titan X GPU. Basically, this thing is built for supercomputers.
Yeah.
This graphics card is made for the highest of the high end. I mean, this graphics card alone is probably going to run you a couple thousand dollars.
Yeah, it looks like something out of Iron Man.
Yeah, it kind of does. It's if anyone else is unaware with their Titan line of graphics cards, they're high end. They're the highest of the high end graphics cards you can get. I mean, yeah. they put these things in supercomputers.
Make sure I throw that out.
I'm talking people who have octa-core, there's liquid cooling, 50 gigabytes of RAM, all this other type of stuff. I mean, these things are built. these things are built to be put in the supercomputers that some people build. let's see. The Titan Z, actually made by NVIDIA. And I think this was their latest one. I'm not sure. It runs for $3,750.
Man.
And there's ones for even that are even more expensive. And this is marked down from $5,357.
Oh, man.
That's a savings of $1,600.
Oh, well, thank goodness.
Oof. But yeah, these things are no joke. These things will kick the ass of at least anybody I know's gaming computer.
Same.
Yeah. These things are stuff NASA uses.
Yeah.
When they're rendering galaxies and shit like that, you know?
Yeah. All right, so.
Ah, we have a French person in the chat.
Hello.
Bonjour.
Bonjour. I was telling someone this actually not that long ago, like probably 30 minutes ago, how I took French in high school. I don't even know why. My logic was like, it sounds pretty cool, so I'm gonna do it.
Parlez-vous anglais, Begbou? My French is not that good.
Yeah. It's not like something you use every day. I don't blame you.
I very not very often at all, no.
You know, it's like the funniest thing though, because like it's been so long since high school, obviously. There's a lot of French stuff on like women's cosmetics or like hair products, so I'll just be like in the shower or something and I'll start reading the French and it just all comes rushing back. I'm like, whoa.
That's pretty cool. I mean,
Weird.
your mind never forgets. It just puts those areas to sleep until it needs to be nudged and woken up. Speaking of reading, a veteran Dragon Age writer has moved to a secret new BioWare project.
I really want to know what the secret project is.
Everybody wants to know what any secret project is,
I know. You just say secret and you're like, oh.
but if it's BioWare, I really want to know.
Yeah.
What are they doing? What's BioWare doing? Does it have anything to do with Mass Effect? The new
Yeah.
Mass Effect?
Yeah, exactly. So, don't
But
know.
yeah, he's worked on Dragon Age Origins, Dragon Age 2, Dragon Age Inquisition, as well as Knights of the Old Republic and Neverwinter Nights. So this guy's mainly fantasy focused with a bit of sci-fi with the Knights of the Old Republic, but oof, I'm curious. I'm very, very curious.
Such a tease.
But yeah, it says after 10 years working on the fantasy franchise, David Gator is making a big change.
Well, good.
Anything BioWare related, I'm into. Just give it to me.
Give it to me now.
All right, moving on to Xbox news. There's actually a bit of it to talk about. One of the main ones is Phil Harrison is expected to leave Microsoft.
Allegedly.
Well, one says he resigned and one says he's expected to leave it. So, I
Well, you
mean,
probably did. They're just like, we couldn't say anything, so.
we can't say anything until all the paperwork's done.
Exactly. But I mean, yeah. It's probably a thing.
I wonder if he's going to work for EA. Because that's what the last one did.
Knows?
Well, not the last one, but the one who got his body all tattooed for Halo. Remember that?
I know who you're talking about, but I don't know his name, so.
He got a Halo 2 tattoo and a Halo 3 tattoo to announce the release dates of Halo 2 and Halo 3.
Dedication.
Yeah. But also, Phil Spencer has addressed both the Xbox Live and PSN DDoS attacks while also discussing issues with Halo.
Dude, every time anyone ever mentions that Halo, it just makes me like cringe, like,
Like, I wanted it to be good so badly, and then I fucked it all up.
Everyone did. And it was like the biggest hype.
Oh.
Everyone just wanted to play. And then once we get to play, nope, you can't. You can have it, but you can't play it.
You can't play online. Just go play single player. You'll be fine. But the thing is, though, it doesn't make any sense. They're so good with their multiplayer. How did they fuck this up so badly?
Well, I mean, apparently they did all the tests and it seemed okay, but for whatever reason, once it went public and everyone had it, for whatever reason, these problems arise, and they never really said what exactly they were and for what reason they could find these problems. But it's just something that allegedly slipped past them. So, I mean, whatever. And then he goes on, Spencer goes on to say that it's just something that they need to get better at. I mean, yeah, obviously, but...
Yeah, but on the bright side, we get Halo 3 ODST for free.
True.
The and there's also ODST is gonna be
updates, so hopefully it'll fix it if you guys are even still interested in playing.
I'll play it if they fix it. I will play that if they fix it, because I love Halo. Well, I mean, that's where we I pretty much got started on the first FPSs was Halo 2.
Alright. So we'll see. Hopefully. Fingers crossed. Spencer also announces the new Xbox One, HoloLens, and Windows 10 plans at GDC.
Well, that's very interesting and very exciting. I'm excited for HoloLens. That is something I am very much looking forward to. Mainly because, while virtual reality is fun, holograms.
Right?
Yeah. Forget virtual reality. How about virtual reality in reality?
Whoa. But yeah, I mean, you see them all the time in movies, and now hopefully they can be like a thing.
I mean, Minority Reports are the biggest example of it.
For sure.
I mean, being able to control the screens and stuff like that, and... it was also a prominent feature in Watch Dogs, if anybody played that.
Yeah.
Nope.
All this stuff, one day, that's, like, science fiction is just gonna be reality, so, like, it's kind of weird.
Well, hey, a lot of the stuff that we have now actually came from science fiction. I mean, yeah. Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy, for instance, was the first example of what a tablet was, basically. The guidebook was essentially a tablet, and this was decades before anybody even thought of anything like that. Anybody even thought that it would be possible to make something like that. I mean, science fiction, it becomes science reality every day.
Yep. It's exciting. Science, people. Science and technology. But, yeah, so HoloLens, Xbox, Windows 10, they all want to be, I don't know, what's the word, like, merge and work on all the different platforms.
Yeah.
So that's cool.
On sad news, however, it was, The Microsoft HoloLens designer was recently killed in a hit-and-run accident. This really sucks.
Yeah.
I mean, we mentioned this before. It's sad whenever anybody in the industry dies. It's sad when anybody dies, period, but...
Yeah.
Especially if it's in an industry, if it's in our industry, because it can usually lead to setbacks, delays, and even cancellations of certain products or projects.
Yep. So that's very, very unfortunate.
However, it has been found, the hit and run driver has been found, in, actually. That's good. And he's being held on $100,000 bail and is facing vehicle manslaughter.
Good.
And felony hit and run charges.
Good.
Ooh. Yeah, it says he was...
Well, on a lighter note...
He was reportedly rear-ended on the highway by a car traveling at over 100 miles per hour.
Man.
That's just insane. You think the guy would have seen him and stopped, and at least slammed on his brakes.
You never know. Never know. We all use common sense. There probably wouldn't be all the accidents that there are, but fortunately, that's not the case.
Yeah. But as you were saying, on the lighter side, we have Rock Band news.
Woohoo! Rock Band! Xbox One and PS4. I'm excited.
Me too.
Yeah. I'd buy it.
For sure.
Just because I miss the whole music genre. It says, it's been 5 years since the last Rock Band game came out.
Yeah, it's been a while. And we mentioned this, what was it, last week when there was speculations about a new one coming out?
Yeah.
Your first remark, what about all the old guitars that I have for it? Well, they're working on the compatibility to hopefully be able to use those.
Yeah, because it would suck to have to rebuy everything if you still have all your stuff.
Right?
Yeah.
And they're working on the DLCs as well. So if you have the DLCs for the older ones, then hopefully you'll be able to play those songs on the newer ones.
That would be nice. That would be nice. I mean, I didn't buy very much DLC, but for those of you that did, that's good news for you.
I only bought one, and it didn't work, so I just boycotted the rest of them. I was like, F it.
But we do already have at least four confirmed songs that are going to be in the new Rock Band, and they're saying, I mean, five songs, and these are the songs that Harmonix says you have to play on Rock Band 4. They include James Gang, Funk Number 49, Jimi Hendrix, Purple Haze, Stevie Wonder, Sir Duke, Queen, Don't Stop Me Now, and Tenacious D Tribute.
I'm so excited.
Now, I'm not sure about you guys, but Queen, Don't Stop Me Now. Freddie Mercury all the way.
Yeah, that's going to be a good one for sure. I'm super.
Yeah, Freddie Mercury's the shit, man. And I hope that's not the only Queen song they have. Who wants to play Another One Bites the Dust? Or who wants to play We Will Rock You, or We Are the Champions?
Yeah.
All those would be awesome. Definitely. But that might be a bit tough, though, because I do believe at least one of the ones I just mentioned was on a Guitar Hero game. So they might have the IP for that.
Yeah, I'm not sure which one, but I remember one of them was, yeah. Moving on to tech news. No, a cryptocurrency can't fix a broken economy.
Yeah, so what's up with this is apparently the banks took a dive in Iceland. And so the government gave everybody cryptocurrency.
This kind of made me laugh, because I was like, really, guys? Really?
Aurora Coin is the digital currency given as a free handout to every resident of Iceland, as supposed to be a salvo for a country rackled by a broken financial system.
I mean, it sounds good on paper, so if you just were to present it, like, hey, it's a good idea, like, okay, I can kind of see it, but, like, if you know anything about economy and how money works, it's not.
But the interesting thing is, it became the second largest cryptocurrency before it even launched, valued at $500 million at its peak.
Yeah, that's crazy.
So, whenever they got that cryptocurrency, they immediately jumped on the marketplace and started selling that cryptocurrency. Those guys cleaned up.
Yeah. Which a lot of people are calling it a scam, because if you really thought this would work, then I think there's something really wrong with you.
Basically, whoever made it to the marketplace first cashed in big.
Yeah.
Because once it started circulating, the value dropped significantly.
Well, there wasn't even places for people to cash in said money. Like, places weren't really taking it.
Well, the thing with cryptocurrency is you usually have to go to a website. It's a currency, so like any other currency, you need to change it over into your local currency if you can't find a local, if you can't find a store that takes it.
Yeah, and I guess a lot of them weren't, so
because it's kind of like Bitcoin. You don't there are some places now that take Bitcoin. Actually, there's a couple big places like Overstock.com started taking it a couple of years ago, and they're still talking about it maybe coming to Amazon, but.
Oh.
But otherwise, you go to a website and you go to a Bitcoin exchange online and exchange it for your local currency, which in this case would be U.S. dollars for us. But and actually, just recently, they've started putting up actual Bitcoin ATMs where you can get money out for exchanging your Bitcoins.
Really? I didn't know that.
Yeah, there's one. They're extremely rare, but I believe there's one or two in New York City. I think there's one in Washington D.C., and they're very rare, very hard to find right now. But they do exist, and there's Bitcoin cafes in New York too, where you can go and you can get a cup of coffee or something like that, and there's exchanges too, and you can do exchanges there too.
Oh.
So, cryptocurrency's really taken off, and I'm really impressed at the rate it has.
Yeah, but unfortunately not in this case.
No, but... Freddie Mercury is not overrated. You, sir, just have... You're just tone deaf.
Whoa, who said that?
Freaky Freddie.
I think it's a generation thing. Like, if you can't appreciate the older generation, like, he was pretty big. Him, the music, the band, like,
yeah,
everything. It's pretty big. But, I mean, I guess, I don't know. I can see how today's generation wouldn't think that, but I don't know.
I dare him to look at some of his favorite bands and see how many of them list Queen as their influence. You'd be surprised at how many list the Beatles as their influence.
Yeah. Well, you know what I was talking about to someone the other day, actually? Not, like, that I'm bashing the Beatles or anything. Like, they're great and they're, like, legends. But it's kind of weird to think about how their music is so simple, yet they're so big, and, like, they're always going to be remembered. So it's kind of like, I think nowadays it's hard for bands to, like, do big things. Like, they were, like, the next big thing then, but, like, now, like, what is the big thing now? I just think it's harder for bands today.
Yeah. Especially with the whole manufactured music thing that started happening in the 90s and carried on into recent times and still has yet to, unfortunately, go away.
That's a whole another debate for, I think.
Yeah. I mean, don't get me wrong. Some of the stuff isn't half bad, but...
Yeah, I feel you on that. But anyway, moving on.
Moving on.
A quantum computer isn't nearly as glamorous as it sounds. This was a pretty funny, I thought, just because when you think quantum computer, you think of something really crazy. But then when you look at it, it's literally just kind of like a brick sitting on a desk. No bells and whistles.
Well, quantum computer is all about the small stuff.
I'm not going to say anything.
You just had to go there.
Because that's like the first thing that was in my head. I'm like, Ashley Doe, but I'm like,
But yeah, quantum computers are built to be small, compact things that are extremely, extremely powerful.
Yeah.
That's what most people think of when they think of quantum computers.
Yeah, but I mean, it's still pretty cool, nonetheless.
So basically, that was just about them not looking like people thought they would, is what I gather from the story.
Basically, yeah. Yeah, I mean, it still does what you think it does, but it just doesn't look like anything special.
You could carry a quantum computer in your pocket.
I mean, I guess you could. Yeah.
Is that a super, speaking of going there, is that a supercomputer in your pocket, or are you just happy to see me?
I was gonna go there. I was like, no, don't do it, but you did, so.
Make you feel better.
Yeah. Anyway.
Moving on to phone news. This week we saw, I believe it was the Mobile World Conference.
Yeah.
Yeah.
This was pretty cool, the HTC One M9.
Which we talked about in the previous episode.
Yeah, we've talked about a couple of these, if not all of them, except for one of them, I think.
It looks pretty good. And
Yeah.
spec wise, it sounds like a real solid phone. And I have the M8. I'm probably gonna upgrade.
You down for the M9? That's
Yeah,
a good gun. Reminds me of a gun.
increase specs. I mean, that's what it all comes down to.
For sure.
And another thing, again, we've talked about all these. We've mentioned the teasers and all the leaks and stuff like that, but now they're all officially announced, and they look pretty good. And speaking of which, Samsung announced what we thought they were going to announce: two versions of the Galaxy S6, the regular S6 and the S6 Edge.
Okay, this phone looks amazing. Like, it's freaking beautiful. Like, it's so pretty. It makes me want to switch over. Go to the dark side.
It is a pretty phone, I will say that. The Edge looks so good. Just the screen wrapping around the little edges, the little bezel, and it's very nice.
Oh,
It's a nice phone. It's a very, very nice phone.
yeah, it's very nice. Throw that up for people to see, but
It's
it's just so
got
cool.
a the phone will be is all metal and glass, and will come in 32, 64, and 128 gig models, and will have a 577 pixel per inch display, which puts it just above the Galaxy S5. It'll be running Android 5.0 Lollipop, and it features a 16 megapixel rear and 5 megapixel front facing cameras, and it has low light capabilities because the cameras are flat f 1.9. Not really sure what that means, but
Wait. Phone features.
and it
Phone.
has a freaking octa core. It has an 8-core processor. That's more powerful than my desktop.
Yeah, it made me. The specs made me really excited about this, and I want this phone. I do.
This phone has a better processor than my desktop. I'm a little bit peeved about that,
I think
but
that's awesome, though. I mean.
yeah, phones are definitely becoming the next big thing when it comes to computing.
Oh, yeah.
Speaking of curved phones, I know this isn't on the list, but or is it on the list? It might be later on in the list. LG is basically putting curved phones on everything now. Curved screens on
Yeah.
everything.
I'll probably get one.
Yeah. That
I
was
think, I don't think
been
it's its
off
own
topic.
story, but I think it was another story that's.
Yeah.
No, I
Then
mean, it's
we
totally on topic
have
now.
the most secure. Is this the most secure smartphone on Earth? This is pretty interesting. It's basically a hyper-encrypted smartphone. It's made by Smart Circle, and it's called Black Phone 2 and Black Phone Plus. The products were unveiled at the Mobile World Congress, and it will be running an updated version of the company's secure operating system, Private OS 1.1. The OS, which is a modified version of Android 4.4.2, places emphasis on encryption while browsing the internet, making phone calls, and instant messaging.
Yeah, I mean, I guess if you need it, there's always these hacks in the news. So, like, maybe if you're like, I don't know, a really big company or something. celebrity or something.
If you basically if you're concerned about security, get this phone.
You've got weird stuff to hide on your phone.
If you're CIA, FBI, or a hacker, or just anybody who wants privacy, get this phone. It sounds like it's for you.
This next phone, okay, I'm gonna butcher. See, Xiaomi Mi Note. It's a Chinese phone.
Xiaomi Mi Note.
Yeah, that. Chinese phone. It's great, but we can't use it because it's not available in the US, so that's a bummer.
It's a beautiful phone, though. This is a phablet. This is a phablet. It's very reminiscent of kind of like a an Android phone meets an Apple phone.
I could see that, yeah, for sure. Apparently it works really well, and
The
mean,
screen
it's
is
funny.
beautiful. I mean, the whole phone itself is it is a beautiful, beautiful phone.
Pretty cool.
It's the Chinese equivalent of it's on sale for the Chinese equivalent of $370 off. That's off contract too. So that's a cheap phone considering how awesome it is. And it's got a 5.7 inch screen, so.
Yeah. So maybe they'll pick it up.
So it's definitely a phablet. It's basically, I think it says it's a little bigger than the 6 Plus. Or about the
Thought it
same.
was about like around the same size.
Yeah, about the same size as the 6 Plus. So if you like the 6 Plus, the size of the 6 Plus, or if you have another phablet, this thing sounds like it might just be right up your alley. Sturdy construction and great guts, from what I understand, too.
Yeah.
When it comes to phones, it's all about the guts. And it's got dual SIM cards too, which means you can actually run two different carriers off it.
Just for kicks.
Like, hey, but if you have a straight talk SIM card, that way you have the unlimited data, you can just switch over to that SIM card when you're using your data, or if you want to use your Verizon SIM card, you can switch over to that to make phone calls and all that other type of stuff. Phone text for with the Verizon SIM card and straight talk with the for the infinite data. If you're rich enough to
Sounds
have
like
two
a
phone
lot.
plans.
Yeah.
Moving on, we have okay, see now this I think we covered in the first podcast actually. Remember the RC Millennium Falcon?
Yeah, we did.
RC TIE Fighter. Well, TIE Interceptor. Chris might like this.
Did you see this one, Chris?
No, I haven't.
It's made by the same person who did the Millennium Falcon, so it's the same quality work. So this guy knows what he's doing, and
Yeah.
it looks really good. It's pretty zippy too, just like the Millennium Falcon was.
Yeah, that's pretty cool. Pretty cool.
And now, Night Facts security experts believe wish that you knew.
Speaking of security,
Yeah.
I
Having this,
mean,
some of this stuff is a bit no-brainer.
it should be, that's what I was about to say.
It should be common. Should be. Keyword is should be common sense. But what are you gonna do? Some people, am I right?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, it's your basic stuff. Like, have a good, strong password. Have different passwords.
Just because a device is new doesn't mean it's safe.
Yeah.
Well, there was something last week about the whole Superfish from Lenovo. Remember that? The whole Superfish adware that came pre-installed on all Lenovo computers and stuff. So.
Yeah.
So just because it's new doesn't mean it's safe.
Exactly. Like every device, every computer, like, it's
Needs
all
to
got
need need to have a
backdoors, holes.
virus. You need to have a virus scan software installed. You need to have a firewall. You need to have this stuff.
Yep.
It's just no ifs, ands, or buts about it.
Definitely. Every time someone tells me, "Oh, it's all right, I don't need it," I'm just like, "Oh."
That being said, however, even the best software has security vulnerabilities.
Yeah, true too.
So run those scans, people. Or li or ha set your so vi your scanning software to automatically scan at least once a week.
Always update.
And yes, always keep your virus definitions updated. New stuff comes out all the time.
Yes.
Every website and app should use HTTPS, which is secure H which is the secure version of HTTP. The cloud is not safe, it just creates new security problems.
Yeah, like everything goes on there too, so you should really think about it.
That if anybody remembers the celebrity scandal from like a couple months ago, where the celebrities were uploading photos of themselves to the cloud, and that the point of the cloud is it's a community server, and if it that's all on one share on shared servers somewhere out there in the world, so that stuff, if somebody hacks that server, they get access to everything that
Yeah.
is on that cloud server. Your stuff, your neighbor's stuff, the person 25 counties over, you know? I mean,
It's true. That's just be smart, you know? Like, know what you're using, know its capabilities, know its downfalls. Like, just, be knowledgeable.
and this the next one is something you already said. Software updates are crucial for your protection. Update your shit.
I know it's inconvenient. I know it takes time, but it's like, oh, like I'm doing something.
Every time you start up your computer and you get the notification, Java needs an update, Flash needs an update, this needs an update, that needs an update. Do it.
Yeah, just
Don't
do
put it off. You can wait 2 or 3 minutes while your software updates.
It's not worth it. It's just so much more of a hassle and headache. When something bad happens, you're gonna wish you did it. So just do it.
The next one. Hackers are not criminals. Despite decades of evidence to the contrary, most people think hackers are the evil adversaries who want nothing more than to steal their digital goods. But hackers can wear white hats as well as black ones. There's white hat, gray hat, and black hat hacking. Just so you know. I'm not gonna say anything else. And the white hats break into systems in order to get there before the bad guys do. Once the vulnerabilities have been identified by hackers, they can be patched. Basically, actually, that's an interesting thing that a lot of white hackers do. They purposely hack into systems and then notify the system of their vulnerabilities, and usually there's a reward for that. People get paid for hacking into systems and exposing vulnerabilities that the bad guys might actually exploit in the future.
Yeah, well, no one really talks about that, so that's why everyone's like, oh no, hackers, they're all bad, but you need hackers.
You
You need
need
hackers for security.
there's good hackers and there's bad hackers, and honestly, a lot of hackers usually become security ex digital security experts, so cybersecurity experts.
So if you're a hacker, you good.
Unless you're a black hat. But even then, not all black hats are bad. It's all perspective, you know?
With great power comes great responsibility.
Hey, there's a quote Chris can appreciate.
He's like dying.
Yeah, he's dying. He's like, I don't want to be here. I just want to go to bed. Get me a neti pot.
Really. Have you guys ever used those, by the way?
No.
They just look like you're gonna die and drown.
Yeah, I don't get how they work, and honestly, I'm not real fond of pouring steamy hot lick fluid into my nasal passages. Thank you.
Yeah, just like go straight up and straight down. It's like you're suffocating. You're drowning.
Anyway, cyber attacks and cyber terrorism are exceedingly rare. Most people think it's they're always hearing about something happening somewhere, and they think it's they're all bad, and they don't happen that often. They don't happen anywhere near. I mean, real cyber attacks and real cyber terrorism don't happen as often as most people think. Here's another one, and this is number 9. Darknet and deep web are not the same thing. The deep web refers to part of the internet, specifically the World Wide Web, that isn't indexed by search engines, so can't be accessed by Google. The darknet refers to non-World Wide Web networks where users may need separate software to access them. For example, Silk Road and many illicit markets are hosted on darknet networks like I2P and Tor.
Yep.
All right. Now that that's out of the way, we're done with the tech news. I believe that was the last one, right? Hey, it's Tux Queen. Hey, Tux Queen. AP's sick, so he's not here right now.
So, entertainment news: new Alien won't undo Alien 3 or Resurrection. Neil Blomkamp. What do you guys think about that?
I mean, I'm glad that they're setting it after Aliens, because let's face it, Aliens 3 and Resurrection probably weren't the best entries into the Alien franchise. I mean, they weren't bad, but they just weren't up to par, I guess I would could should say. What do you think, Chris?
Alien 3 was unneeded, and Alien Resurrection was just like complete opposite direction.
Well, there you go. He's our entertainment expert. Listen to him.
Right? He literally knows like everything and then just stuff I've never heard of, so yeah. Aw,
And
Drew Goddard could direct and write Spider-Man.
yeah, we're going into the Spider-Man news.
Woohoo!
So, what's your opinion on Drew Goddard, the possibility of Drew Goddard directing and writing the new Spider-Man?
Me?
Yes, you.
I never heard of him, so if he can
Let's
do.
see. He did Sinister Six. He Looks like all that work on the never seen Sinister Six movie may pan out after all. For Cabin in the Woods director Drew Goddard, rumor has it he's meeting with Sony right now to reboot Spider-Man. I liked Cabin in the Woods. Cabin in the Woods was a pretty good
Yeah,
horror
it was a good
movie.
movie,
I
so.
did too. Yeah.
And he also did Buffy.
Oh, okay. I mean, I guess it should be interesting then.
Yeah.
It sounds like it's more of like a darker side. So maybe we'll get more of an edgier Spider-Man.
Bit of
Yeah,
an edgier
worse.
Spider-Man, that might be interesting.
We'll hopefully see like a post-credit scene in Age of Ultron with Spider-Man.
Yeah.
My thing is because Iron Man is supposed to appear in Spider-Man's standalone film, I'd like to see a post-credit scene where Iron Man's getting ready to blast something, and a web comes in and grabs Iron Man's hand, and Spider-Man says, "Can I join in?" Like Peter Parker status.
Yeah, that'd be funny.
That would be funny. I can just imagine the
You guys had all the fun last time. I wonder how they're going to write him in for having been missing during the fight of New York, the fight for New York. Because they're going to have to make an excuse for him, and I'm pretty sure they know that.
Yeah. I don't know. We'll see.
So we have three possible Spider-Mans when it comes to casting rumors. We have John Hutcherson, Dylan O'Brien, and Freddie Highmore.
Yeah, all for Peter Parker, but there's Donald Glover who wants to, if they do the Miles Morales Spider-Man.
Yeah. So what's your opinion on those guys?
Well, if Josh Hutcherson becomes Spider-Man, it's going to be like, oh, the guy from Hunger Games. Big whoop.
Yeah, I'm not really on board with that either.
What about Freddie Highmore, who actually compared Spider-Man to Norman Bates?
I don't know, because it's like, I like that show, I like him as an actor, but, I mean, I don't know if I see it, but it's not to say that it's impossible, because I don't know. I don't know.
Nada.
Yeah, like, I don't know, because, like, I've never seen him in anything really super action-y. Like, he's just, I know he can be really dramatic, and he can be, like, for an intense character. Like,
basically, you're not sure if he can pull off the superhero thing.
Yeah, like, I don't know if I see him as a superhero. Like, I don't see him as Spider-Man. Like, I don't know.
How about Dylan O'Brien?
Never heard of him.
Maze Runner and Teen Wolf actor.
I'm not on board with him either. I feel like they're just taking people who have done, like, I don't know, bigger stuff, and they're just like, you know, they're probably a good idea, but...
Never heard of them. Don't care. I'd rather have them bring back Tobey Maguire.
Yeah, I could see that, but he'd have to be a little older. They would have to start him already out of high school.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, he was already in his 20s. When they did Spider-Man, and now he's probably in his 30s, so... Yeah, they'd have to make him a bit older. Make Spider-Man a bit older, if they did bring Tobey Maguire back.
Oh, it doesn't look like they're going to, though. They're obviously going for the younger...
Yeah.
...actor.
They're going for the high school Spider-Man.
Yeah.
Hugh Jackman thinks Wolverine Avengers could happen.
Well, if Sony and Marvel can work out a deal, so can Fox and Marvel.
I don't see why not. I mean, I'd love to see it.
I'd love to see Wolverine and Tony Stark just get into an argument.
Oh yeah, that would be interesting. That would certainly chill out, be bub. Apparently a lot of people think they're already teasing this in the latest Avengers trailer, because you see somebody with claws.
It's actually Hawkeye.
Hawkeye?
Yeah. He's got new gadgets, and what you see protruding out of his wrist is actually a 9-round,
arrow launcher or something?
Arrow launcher.
Yeah, that's pretty cool.
So people are like, what the fuck, Klaus? Is that what you made? But no, it's Hawkeye, because you can clearly see the bowstring below.
Oh, that's cool. And he's apparently he's got some explaining to do, because where was he during the fall of S.H.I.E.L.D.?
Yeah.
I mean, all we have is the actors... guessing at where Hawkeye was during the fall of S.H.I.E.L.D., but there's nothing official been said by Marvel about where Hawkeye was during the fall of S.H.I.E.L.D. Speaking of Avengers and Marvel, AMC is going to be showing every Marvel Studios movie in an ultimate marathon, right, going from April 29th to April 30th, starting with the first Thor mo first Iron Man movie and ending with the latest movie, Avengers: Age of Ultron.
And I plan on singing it.
It is a 27-plus-hour Ultimate Marvel Marathon, starting with Iron Man, going to Incredible Hulk, then Iron Man 2, then Thor, then Captain America, the First Avenger, then the First Avengers movie, then Iron Man 3, then Thor, the Dark World, then Captain America, the Winter Soldier, followed by Guardians of the Galaxy, then, lastly, Age of Ultron.
Oh, man.
I think I would fall asleep during First Avenger and the Dark World.
I think I'd fall asleep during Iron Man 2 in the Dark World.
I agree with that.
Because Iron Man 2 was a lot more slow-paced, and so was Thor: The Dark World.
Yeah.
But I think I'd be fine for the rest.
Oh my God, like that's such a long time though. Like when I first heard about this, I was so gung-ho and I was like, I'm doing it, I'm gonna do it. And then I sat down, I was looking at tickets, I'm like, wait a minute. Like that's over a day long.
Yeah,
That's crazy.
27 hours. I mean, I'm
I don't
sure
know if
there's
I can
going to
do
be
it.
like intermissions between the shows, 'cause there's no way they're going to go back to back to back to back to back to back to back without giving people at least a chance to go to the bathroom or the concession stand. Well, let's see. You know what? We can actually look this up. How long is the first Iron Man movie? Because Iron Man starts at 6, and then the Incredible Hulk starts at 8:25. So if
Hold on.
Iron Man's a 2-hour long movie, that means there's a 25-minute long break between the movies. Which I think would be reasonable, wouldn't you?
Yeah, that's pretty reasonable. Jesus. That's crazy, though. And then you're probably only going to be eating like theater food the whole time.
See, this is one of those things where I think they should allow people to bring in their own snacks because it's just too much, man. Nobody's going to be able to buy a day's worth of food at theater prices. It's just not going to happen. So they should allow people to bring in 6 packs of soda and bags of chips and stuff like that, you know?
Yeah, otherwise you're basically just gonna have hot dogs and nachos and their crap.
And then you gotta think about price. Now, I'm thinking it's gonna be about $100, 100 to 150 bucks. Because that you're occupying a theater for over an entire day. And each movie, too, that's like 9 movies.
Yeah, have we not
That's
found like
11 movies. No, I don't think they've even announced prices yet. I think they've just announced the marathon and the schedule for it.
Iron Man is, I believe, 2 hours and no, 2 hours and 6 minutes.
So yeah, that's about 20 minutes then for in between Iron Man and the Incredible Hulk. So that's perfectly reasonable. But if you disclude the credits, because I don't think there was an end credit scene for the first Iron Man, was there? I know there was an Iron Man 2 and all the rest of them. I don't think there was an
Well,
Iron Man or the first Incredible Hulk.
the Incredible Hulk runs 1 hour and 52 minutes. And then it's what, Thor?
Iron Man 2, then Thor.
Hours and 4 minutes.
For Iron Man 2.
Yeah.
So let's see, from 10:30, that would put it at midnight. Like at. So that would put it at 12:40, and then Thor starts at 1 a.m. So yeah, they're giving you like 20 minutes between each video, so between each
Yeah.
movie. So
Thor is 1 hour and 55.
again,
What's after
15 to 20
Thor?
minutes, Captain America: The First Avengers. But so yeah, 15 to 20 minutes between each movie, that's not that bad. That's pretty reasonable, I'd say.
Yeah, 2 hours.
So if basically what we're saying is if you have an AMC near you, they don't have times or prices yet for this, but check back around near the end of April on their website or at your local AMC
Well,
and
check
hopefully
this
they'll
out.
have information for you.
Age of Ultron's 2.5 hours.
And that starts at 7 o'clock.
So
So
about 10 o'clock. I mean, 9:30, 10 o'clock, you'd be
9:30.
getting up.
So that's 24, 25, 26, 27 and a half hours from the beginning of Iron Man 2 to from the beginning of Iron Man to the end of Avengers Age of Ultron. So that's a lot.
Oh, yeah, that's a long time. I can't even sit for like 2 hours like getting antsy. Jeez.
We'll have to
I'm
strap you down.
gonna get
We'll have to strap
No.
you down.
Yeah, I guess so. I would be so fidgety.
Or get you high.
Just
We
like,
do not condone the use of drugs.
no. I mean, if you guys have noticed the past, like, what, two podcasts, we don't at all.
All right, moving on to science news. The discovery of 8,000-year-old wheat could rewrite ancient British history. This is pretty
Yeah.
interesting. This is pretty interesting. It basically means that they had trade routes open long before we thought that they did. The presence of wheat on the British Islands a full 2,000 years before farmers began cultivating cereal grains means hunter-gatherers and many established important trade connections in Europe.
Yeah, that's pretty cool. I mean, I don't know why it hasn't been found before now, but it's very interesting.
Archaeologists believe that farming didn't reach the British Isles until about 6,000 years ago. So the presence of it being there full 2,000 years beforehand, yeah, that's a very significant find.
Definitely.
It definitely means that they had established trade routes already for at such a time is very interesting. We're always finding new stuff out about the past and about our probable future. Speaking of probable future, NASA scientists have found a way to synthesize building blocks of life.
I thought this article was super cool. I don't even know where to begin. So, they found a way to reproduce the elements of RNA and DNA.
Yeah. And that is big. That is like really big.
Yeah.
And believe it or not, the molecule primadine, which is found in meteorites, exists as a bonding structure for these building block elements. More proof that we are made of star stuff.
Yeah, exactly, because these same elements, they're found in meteorites, and then you take the ice samples in a vacuum chamber and you create these genetic elements. Like, that's just like that's so
We're
cool.
blowing some minds.
Yeah. Very cool.
And now we're gonna look earthward from the sky with these two tiny satellites were launched from ISS.
Yeah, I didn't really like what are they trying to get with these satellites?
The nano satellites were deployed by the NanoRacks launcher at the end of the Japanese robotic arm of the ISS on Friday. The tiny CubeSats are loaded with tools to observe the planet. CubeSats are NASA's nanosatellite program for lightweight, self-contained experiments that can fly as small auxiliary payloads on planned launches. A few are tucked into most cargo runs and to the space station, an added bonus for science to the regular payload. The Dove satellites are about triple the length of normal cube-shaped satellites, 10 centimeters per side by 30 long, weighing about 6 kilograms. Half a kilogram is a pound, so that's 12 pounds. That's interesting. That they're small.
Yeah, very small. Pretty. And they're controlled by astronauts?
It says they're lacking in sophisticated orbital stabilization equipment. CubeSats are in decaying orbits and typically only remain in space for a few months to years before burning up in the atmosphere. Doves are no different, carrying only a reaction wheel to stabilize their orbits. Just more satellites up there to check out down here, you know?
That's cool.
But yeah, mini satellites. Why not, right?
Because why not?
Speaking of why not, it's time to go alien hunting on Titan.
Sounds like my jam. Move over, Europa. There's another moon out there to claim the title of first place we'll discover extraterrestrial life.
And this is actually really interesting because Titan is awash with oceans of liquid methane and a blistering minus 290 degree Fahrenheit surface. But apparently that doesn't stop life because we've discovered that there might be a... There's a new hypothetical cellular organism, methane-based cell, that might live in methane's oceans. It's called a azotosum. Azotosum? There we go.
Yeah.
So, yeah, that's really interesting.
That is pretty exciting.
It says the azotosum is made from nitrogen, carbon, and hydrogen molecules known to exist in the cryogenic seas of Titan, but shows the same stability and flexibility that Earth's analogous lipsum does. Liposome. This came as a surprise to chemists like Clancy and Stevenson, who had never thought about the mechanics of cell stability before. They usually study superconductors, not cells. Excited by the initial proof of concept, Clancy said that the next step is to try and determine how these cells would behave in a methane environment, what might be the analog to reproduction and metabolism in oxygen-free methane-based cells. So there might be methane-based life in the seas of Titan. I can just imagine all the creepy fish that are down in those seas.
I don't want it. No, thank you.
I mean, we already have creepy fish in the depths of our oceans.
Yeah.
Angler fish, anybody?
No.
Oh, the deep sea is an alien world on our own.
Right? Like, we don't even know what's down there.
Speaking of research, research has achieved record-smashing wireless connection speeds. 5G is coming, people. You heard it here first.
Yeah. So I guess that sucks for all of you who are still on 3G with your outdated phones, because your networks aren't going to be much, aren't going to function very well. But I'm excited for this. Researchers got
they achieved 1 terabyte per second over a 5G connection for the first time ever. That's the fastest wireless speed to date.
Yeah, that's 100 full-length movies downloaded onto your phone in just 3 seconds. That's crazy.
And not to mention that it's 65,000, that's 1,000, times faster than average 4G download speeds.
This makes me so excited. Like, I want it now. Like, can I just have like faster and faster internet now?
And you know what? With the whole net neutrality thing that passed last week, unlimited access.
Yeah, like,
Yeah, that's gonna be fun. Unhindered, unlimited access to the internet. And the faster the internet gets, the better it gets, you know?
I know. Like, I'm super excited, and I don't know, nerd alert, like, nerd freak out.
I'm definitely excited for it too, 'cause the more the faster the easier it gets to upload the larger stuff, the more people are going to upload larger stuff. We're talking videos, we're talking science stuff, research, all this other type of stuff that could lead to better advancements, which could lead to faster internet, which could lead to even more uploads, which could lead to faster internet, which could lead to you see where this is going.
It's infinite.
Eventually, we'll just have instantaneous internet.
Right? One day.
One day in the far-flung future.
So, speaking of space,
No, Darth Bearded One isn't dead. He just has the sniffles.
confirmed.
I'm sick.
Yeah, well, at least you're better off than AP, who lost his voice.
Yeah,
it really sucks.
Okay, moving on. You know, we were talking about space, and we've been talking about Mars practically every week, so more Mars.
Curiosity rover confirms methane on Mars.
And that kind of goes with the whole thing we were just talking about with Titan a little
Yeah.
bit. I mean, if there is methane-based life. But you know, that makes me think, isn't methane usually created by the decomposition of biological matter?
Yes.
So
There's.
where is that methane coming from? I want to see where that methane is coming from.
Well, that's exactly what the article points out, is we it's at such random spots that we can't say where it's coming from. We don't know. So that's to be seen. More research.
But that means that if there is methane on Mars, that means there's about 90% chance now that there was at one point life on Mars.
Yeah, I mean,
Even if it's bio, even if it's just plankton degrading from at one point when Mars had water, which a couple of years ago actually they found out that there is still running water on Mars during the summer near the equator. It was Curiosity found patterns in the sand near the equator that indicated that water had been running there recently. So there is running water occasionally on Mars, which means that at one point there might have been Mars might have had lakes, oceans. So there is a possibility that maybe the methane is coming from decomposing plankton or other plant matter, maybe.
yeah, possibly. We don't know.
Gonna be interesting when we finally get up there.
Oh, man.
Another curiosity. The Curiosity's drill has revealed the inner colors of Mars. Here's a hint, the red planet's gray.
Not so red after all.
So that's pretty interesting. It actually kind of looks like clay when you look at it.
Yeah, it does.
But that might also be due to the low atmosphere of Mars, that it most sands would probably have a consistency of clay because the atmosphere.
Makes sense.
Actually, it does have a. The interesting thing is, they do have an atmosphere, it's just an extremely, extremely, extremely low amount of atmosphere. That being said, NASA has halted Curiosity's work to investigate a short circuit.
Or curiosity.
Well, hey, on the bright side, if they can't figure it out in the next 10 years, maybe one of the Mars One people can go check it out for them.
I guess I better send some engineers.
And our NASA can talk one of them through it, right?
I guess that's true, yeah, maybe.
Okay, and here's one actually you shared with us, Ashley. Energy harvesting for life on Mars.
Yeah, I thought this was pretty cool.
Basically creating light, creating energy from CO2, right?
Yeah, so I guess there's a lot of dry ice that naturally occurs, unlike on Earth. So
Yeah.
if we use that, we can convert it into energy.
So basically a dry ice generator type thing. For
Yeah, so I think.
lack of a better term, at least.
Yeah.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah, so the future missions to Mars may not be so one way after all, if this becomes a bigger thing.
Well, I mean, the Mars One colony is just setting up a colony. I mean, eventually we'll reach the point where we will be able to bring those people back. They're just saying it might take a while. That's why they're guaranteeing you a way there. They're not necessarily guaranteeing you a way back.
We're not coming back. I
Hey, who knows? They might like it there. They might want to stay there.
don't know. Whatever floats your boat.
I thought of submitting an application for it.
I don't think. You think you could do it, though?
I thought about it. I didn't do it.
You're like, no.
I'd love to, but what would you guys do without me?
Oh, okay.
I'm kidding. I'm kidding.
Yeah, I mean the thought's definitely really, really cool, but I don't think
One-way trip to Mars. Yeah.
I'm very comfortable here.
Okay, this next one's pretty interesting, and honestly, I'm all for this. Burial pods that could turn cemeteries into forests.
Yeah, this is cool because essentially you're turning, I don't know what's a good term. I don't want to say waste, but you're productive. It's becoming something. It's put to use.
Yeah, you're returning to the soil and you're giving nutrients to a living thing, a tree.
Yeah, which I think we so desperately need, so we keep hacking them down. So does this mean eventually in the future we're gonna be hacking down cemeteries?
Well, then your memorial tree will become a memorial stump.
My memorial paper.
This paper brought to you by
Grandma Gigi in this paper. Oh man, that's terrible.
just dedicate paper to the cemetery, dedicate or whoever's tree it was.
I can see some company turning that shit and just, oh my God.
But yeah, so it's a starch-based plastic egg-shaped pod that you would be placed in the fetal position. And then your family or whoever, or the groundskeeper or whoever, would plant a tree over the pod, over your grave site, and care for it. And your family would care for it, the gravekeepers would care for it, and it would eventually grow into a nice sturdy tree, which might eventually get cut down in the later future.
Oh man, that's terrible. But I think it's a great idea. Like, it's giving back, putting yourself back into the earth, and now you're something else. You're a tree. You know what would be cool? If you could pick what kind of tree you were, that'd be cool.
Pick the tree that you got planted?
Yeah, like, if, you know, like, not just like the standard, everyone's the same ugly tree.
Yeah.
There were, like, different kinds of trees.
It's like tombstones. Not all the tombstones are the same.
There you go. See, I think that would be really cool. And it's, like, more uplifting. You don't go, like, you know, when you get older, I'm going to go pick out my tombstone, but now you get to go pick out a tree.
I think a nice spruce tree would be nice. Or how about that cherry wood?
Yeah, what kind of tree says me?
how about an orange tree? Then they can... Nah, I'm not going there.
Oh, then you're like eating grandma. Ah.
Well, the grandma's body nourished the tree and allowed it to provide fruit.
I don't know. I just find, like, that's cool, but that's really weird. I feel weird.
How about an apple tree?
I would still feel weird if I'm eating it. I'm just like, oh no.
Well, you're not eating the person. You're eating fruit from the tree that was nourished by the person.
I know, but I don't know. Maybe it's just me.
I can imagine that being a whole thing now. Whole orchards, apple orchards of these things.
Like, family burial plots are now orchards.
Yeah, that I can see that being a thing, actually.
Yeah.
Like, okay, bury her under the apple trees and bury her under the orange trees.
Yeah.
We need more raspberries, so bury him under the raspberry tree.
I can see it.
I can see that being a thing.
Definitely. I think we should start this now. I'm excited about it already.
All right, so this next one is interesting, and actually a little bit creepy. So, a legendary lost civilization buried in the Honduran rainforest has been found thanks to satellites. And this, it's just creepy. They sent a ground team there, to where they found the civilization. And they came back with stuff like pottery and stuff like that. But here's the creepy part. Keep in mind, this is a legendary lost city. It's called the City of the Monkey God.
Yeah.
Or the White City. So the people went there, they checked it out, and when they came back, they said they found statues of were-jaguars and a whole bunch of other stuff. Where I'd be like, huh, ancient lost civilization in the middle of the rainforest with statues of were-jaguars. Yeah, no thanks, I'm out.
See, I find it interesting, probably because it's creepy, but I don't know.
I'd be like, there's some type of curse on this place, isn't there? Watch. There's going to be the people who went there and checked it out first are going to end up turning into were-jaguars and killing people.
God. I'm not going to lie. That would be the coolest thing in the news in a long time.
Like, yeah, it would be.
I mean, unfortunate for them, but that would be pretty cool.
But yeah, it said they uncovered 52 artifacts buried in the soil as well as a manner of earthenworks. Oh, and a were-jaguar. The most striking object emerging from the ground is the head of what Fisher speculates to be a were-jaguar, presumably depicting a shaman in a transformed spirit state. Alternatively, the artifact might be related to ritualized ball games that were featured in pre-Columbian life in Mesopotamia, Mesoamerica. But still, were-jaguar. Yeah.
I'm all for it.
It's Curse of the Mummy all over again.
That's cool. I mean, I don't go near it, I guess, but that's cool.
What's your opinion, Darth? Beardy?
Eh.
Would you go there? Like, if I was like, let's take a Nerd Nation field trip.
to an ancient lost city in the middle of the Honduran jungle that has a statue of a were-jaguar.
Yeah.
Probably not.
He's like, no, I'm good.
Oh, man.
And I don't blame him.
Whatever, guys.
I'd be with you in spirit.
I'm gonna do one of those found footage. I'll like Skype you guys on my phone, like through the forest.
Hey, we'll sell that shit to Sony. We'll make a fortune.
Probably, yeah.
Sony or Fox, one of them will buy it.
As long as you take good care of my tree.
So, what do you want planted over you?
I don't know. Cherry blossoms are nice. Unless you want to, like, make me fruit.
Well, cherry
oranges.
Blossoms
oh, no.
would be
avocado.
Cherries, but...
Avocado trees.
Avocado tree? All right.
That's it. That's the one. Done.
We'll plant a coffee tree over Chris.
Oh, I should have chosen that.
So, moving on to uncategorized news. This one actually was found by Beardy, and sounds interesting, but Taco Bell has created deep-fried, cream-filled Captain Crunch berries, Captain Crunchberry balls.
I'd try them.
Fucking
the jokes write
Bark
themselves.
City. Yeah, they do. I think I would try it. Just to say that I tried it, but it's more.
They're a lot like. I mean, they're based off of the Cinnabon ball, the Cinnabon delights, which are basically fried churro batter with Cinnabon frosting in the middle.
They're but fucking amazing.
They're churros with Cinnabon icing in the middle.
This is already out. Like this is already a thing.
The Cinnabon delights, yeah.
No, the.
The Captain Crunch things, they're being tested at certain Taco Bells. One, it says they're in, one of them's in Bakersfield.
That's too far.
Bakersfield, California. But, the best line from this article says, Taco Bell is currently testing out Captain Crunch's Does This Look Infected to Use Only in Bakersfield, California locations.
Good, give it to them. Legs internal.
But yeah, they basically put food coloring in the batter to make it pink, and then mashed up crunch berries on the outside with like a milky frosting in the middle. Yeah, like I said, the jokes write themselves. Trey says cream filled balls. Count me in.
Right.
Again, the jokes write themselves.
Yeah.
All right. Moving on to, there's a new beehive that lets honey be harvested without disturbing bees. This is actually really good, as usually harvesting honey is extremely stressful for the bees and can sometimes cause more than a few to die in the process.
Yeah. This looks pretty cool. It's like a little, I don't know, just like a dispenser. Is that the right word?
Yeah, sort of. It's got like a faucet like, on it or something.
Yeah, like the big water things, you know? You just like lift up. That's cool.
I mean, I like honey. So anything that helps the bees and gets me more honey, I'm all for it.
I don't think I like use it really unless it's like in something. Or if you're sick, so AP should just be like eating straight honey.
Peanut butter and honey sandwiches are awesome.
I've never tried that.
They're just awesome. I love them.
Would you ever have your own bee farm? Like if you could have one of these little houses?
Yeah, why not? I just need the right equipment.
You doing that, just waking up in the morning, it's like the crack of dawn, just walking outside, and I'm getting my honey.
yeah, I'd raise bees for this. Heck yeah, I like my honey, and bees aren't as bad as most people think, unless you're allergic to them. Then yeah. You should stay away from them at all costs. But yeah, they're actually fairly calm. I mean, unless you try swatting at them, or just generally try to, unless you're generally pissing them off, they'll leave you alone. I mean, they'll land on you. You can hold them and stuff like that. I mean, at the Renaissance Fair here in town, they actually have a bee exhibit, bee thing, where they have sell beeswax candles and honey and beeswax products and stuff like that. And they have an active hive right there. And the guy standing next to the hive who tells you about him usually has a bee or two walking around on his hand. He's just rotating his hand, letting him walk around. And the people that work there are generally pretty cool. They just pick if there's one on a jar or something like that, they like put their finger in front of them, let it crawl up on it, and then to like fly away and stuff like that. I mean, bees can be generally really calm. It's only if you piss them off that you're gonna get stung.
Well, they're probably really passive, considering when they are upset, like their defense basically kills them. So they're like, I'm not gonna fight you unless I really have to.
Yeah, because honeybees, if they die when they sting.
Yeah.
A lot of people don't know that. A lot of people think they can sting again and again, but that's more like the hornets and the wasps and stuff like that.
I feel like those motherfuckers, they're fucking evil.
Yeah, they'll screw with you.
No. But yeah, this is really cool.
Moving on to the bonus round.
Bonus.
So apparently, Sony accidentally deleted the list of anniversary PS4 winners.
Whoops.
Whoops. Yeah.
They say Sony's better than Xbox.
Xbox makes mistakes too. I'm not a fanboy. I'll play both systems. And stuff like that. So. And the next one. Too bad AP's not here. We have more confirmed Mortal Kombat fighters. And also, Mortal Kombat X is also going to be coming to mobile devices. So, cool.
Very cool.
But yeah, the Mortal Kombat fighters so far are... Suspenseful pause. The announced fighters are Kitana, Johnny Cage... Ooh, they confirmed Johnny Cage! That's been a rumor. That's been a rumor for a while, so they must have just recently updated this since last night. Quan Chi, Jacqueline Briggs, Takashi Takeda, Kung Jin, Goro, Melina, Ermac, Scorpion, Sub-Zero, Cassie Cage, Devorah, Kortal Khan, Farah and Tor, Raiden, Kano, Reptile, and Kung Lao. The rumored fighters are still Aaron Black, Sindel, Kenshi, Cyrax, Sonya, Rain, Shinnok, and Jax. Though, honestly, if they bring Johnny Cage, they're going to bring Sonya, because one of the characters, Cassie Cage, is actually Johnny Cage's and Sonya's daughter. So, if you're going to have one of the parents in, you might as well bring both of them in, right?
Yeah.
Going to make for some awkward family moments, though, having to kill your daughter. Or having to kill your parents, depending on who you're fighting with as. But yeah, so Mortal Kombat X is going to be coming to mobile devices such as tablets. That's pretty interesting. Final Fantasy XV marks the start of a realistic new chapter for the series, which honestly, I'm a bit interested to see how they take this new direction, because I mean, I've played a bunch of Final Fantasy games. I haven't played all of them. I've played Final Fantasy 7, 10, 10-2, skipped 11 because it was an MMO, played 12, I played 13, I didn't play 13-2 or 13-2, 13 Lightning Returns, and I didn't play 14 because it's an MMO. Okay, Division's PvP Dark Zones have been detailed, and Division's just one of those games I know I'm excited for. I know you guys are excited for, right?
Oh, I'm so excited. I've been excited, like I said, since they first teased it last year. So stoked about it.
So, yeah, I mean, we all knew PvP was going to play some part in the game, so I'm excited to see that this was announced. And we got a little bit of details to go off of. Oh, and they're also going the Destiny route and will be having a non-combat social hub similar to Destiny's Tower.
Okay.
So, a place where you can meet up with players and stuff like that. Here's hoping it's a little better than Destiny, but...
I mean, it looks... Okay, well, we don't really know because there's not, like, a lot on it.
Yeah.
But we've seen, I think that it does so far.
The footage of it looks fantastic, I will admit. All the gameplay footage we've seen. That being said, moving into casting announcements, we have a whole bunch to go through, including Minority Report TV series is going to star Megan Good as Stark Sands. Dean Cain and Helen Slater are going to be joining the cast of Supergirl. Tom Ellis has been cast as Lucifer in the possibly already doomed Lucifer series. We checked past episodes for our opinion on that. Jane Lynch will be playing a guardian angel in CBS's Angel from Hell. And Supergirl also cast Jeremy Jordan as a potential toy man for the pilot of Supergirl. And which is interesting because Toyman's actually an interesting villain. What's your opinion on him, Chris? Because I know you're into this thing, this type of stuff.
Who?
Toyman, you know, Toyman.
Never heard of him.
Really? He's a major villain from Superman who actually made appearances on Batman too. He made an appearance in actually he was also in Teen Titans. So he's a pretty prominent. I mean, he's not one of the main villains, but he is a recurring villain to be sure. And here's one. What's your opinion of Luke Evans in negotiation to play Gaston for Beauty and the Beast? Random thing.
He looks like he can fit the part. I mean.
Continuing on, we have. Duck Dynasty's Phil Robertson blames hippies for STDs in CPAC speech.
This guy needs to learn to keep his mouth shut.
Yeah. He can claim free speech all he wants. That doesn't keep him from being a moron.
Yeah. I mean, no, not much to say about it. I don't agree with
it.
A lot of people don't agree with it.
He's just a bigoted old redneck.
Yeah.
Here's an interesting one. As sea ice shrinks, polar bears are moving farther north. It's
so sad.
Yeah, but this is actually evolution, sort of. Because younger generations of polar bears have started to migrate north as winter starts to leave and the warmer months start to come in. So that's really interesting that they've already adapted to stuff like this happening.
Well, you gotta, I mean.
Yeah.
Survival.
Okay, next we have a whole bunch of gaming release date news and release news. Five Nights at Freddy's 3 has arrived on Steam.
Have you guys seen or played that yet?
Nope.
No, I might get into the Freddy's thing, but it's not really my type of game. Next is Stealth Inc. 2 is coming to Xbox One, PC, and PlayStation 4 match in April. Final Fantasy X and X-2. Hey, I just mentioned those. HD Remaster is coming to PS4 May 12th. Mad Max release date has been revealed, but the Xbox 360 and PS3 versions have been canned. So Mad Max is going to be coming out September 1st. For those of you that are excited for that. Next is Metal Gear Solid Phantom Pain release date has been announced, and that's November, I believe. Or is that September 2? September 1st also. So Mad Max and Metal Gear Solid 5 both coming out on the same day. It's going to be interesting. Xenoblade Chronicles X may release this summer in the West. Elite Dangerous is coming to Xbox One and PS4. I've been playing that a lot on the computer, and I like it a lot. I think that's going to be fun. I think you might actually get like that too, Chris.
Huh.
Ashley, you might want to check that out too. I mean, it's pretty fun. I mean, flying around space, trading, dogfighting, generally getting into some nasty-ass shit.
Yeah, it sounds interesting.
So, Poltergeist is going to be... Poltergeist, Spy, and Paper Towns release dates have been moved. Poltergeist is now coming out earlier than expected on May 22nd, while Spy has moved from that date to a June 5th slot. Paper Towns, which is based off the Fault in Our Stars author John Green's book of the same name, has been moved to July 24th. So, any of you guys excited for the new Poltergeist remake? Reboot?
I was until I heard that it was kind of going to be like a toned down version. I don't know if they're still going with it, but that's like the last that I heard.
Why tone down the Poltergeist? I mean, it's the Poltergeist. Like,
I don't know. I mean, I don't know. So, I don't know. We'll see. Watch it, but I'm not like excited about it as I was when it was first.
Yeah, that doesn't sound. I wouldn't be excited for it either, after hearing that. But moving on, World of Warcraft is going a route some games already have gone, like EVE Online and Second Life, among others, which is being able to buy game time with in-game gold.
That's cool, I guess.
So basically, if you're committed to World of Warcraft and you have a big cache of gold, you can basically play for free. Your subscription will be paid for with your in-game currency. Which, I mean, if you think about it, that's actually really cool. If you're actually dedicated to the game and you make a lot of money in-game money. Now, last week, here's another thing about something that's gained a lot of money in just the course of a week. You remember last week we mentioned Star Citizen has passed 73 million?
Yeah.
Star Citizen passes $74 million.
Woo!
In a week. So they made over $1 million in a week.
That's crazy.
God of War veteran joins Star Citizen developer. Leonard Nimoy. Both Star Citizen and Elite Dangerous are going to honor Leonard Nimoy in game.
Pretty cool.
Okay, at this point, I think my internet provider is trying to tell me you're sucking up too much bandwidth, you mook.
Yeah.
Hey, I can't help it if this is my job. All right, moving on. Pregnancy puts players into the head of a teenage rape victim. Now, this sounds like a very controversial idea.
Yeah, definitely, I'd say. I mean, I think... I don't know. Like, it's a good idea, but...
Do you really think the general audience for gaming is ready for something like this?
No, like, I don't know how to put my thoughts into words. Because, like, I feel like it's not, like, a bad idea, but I don't...
It's not a bad idea, but I don't think the general gaming public is ready for something like this just yet.
Well, what is it just like a game that's like available to everybody? Like,
Yeah, it's on Steam.
I don't know.
The interactive story Pregnancy, released today on Steam, begins with a 14-year-old Lila Sander purchasing a pregnancy test. It's a painful moment for the teen. She feels ashamed and awkward at home, waiting for the test results. She recalls the horrific act that brought her to this point.
I don't know. I don't know how I feel about it.
I mean,
Maybe it'll spread awareness. Maybe it'll like help people.
yeah, like help people, like you're not alone. It's like one of those you're not alone type things, right?
Yeah, and like a lot of people I don't think can understand. I mean, there's no way you could understand that kind of mental state that you would be in if that actually happened to you. So
Yeah.
maybe it can help other people understand that kind of thing.
Yeah, I can see that. Hashtag sleepy beardy.
Oh, he didn't, did he?
Thankfully, we're almost done.
Oh man.
Walking Dead Town is for sale.
This is pretty cool.
Yeah, I'll agree. This is pretty cool. There he is, he's awake. You awake? You weren't for a second there. But yeah, so a series of buildings in downtown Grantville, Georgia are now for sale on eBay with a starting bid of $680,000. Which when you think about it, that's not that bad considering it's multiple buildings.
Yeah. That's pretty cool.
But yeah, that is really cool. Especially if you're a fan of The Walking Dead.
Oh, for sure.
It says it's dirt cheap at about $30 per square foot. And it says we've done all the dirty work by renovating everything. So there you go. If you're interested in owning it, owning a piece of The Walking Dead. And it says it's also been a part of multiple movies too, including Grantville has also been seen in the feature films Lawless, The War, and Dumb and Dumber 2. So it's a pretty famous town, actually, I guess.
Wow. Who knew?
Bruce Lee's family is developing a feature film biopic. I'd see it.
I think a lot of people would, yeah, for sure.
It's Bruce Lee. Who wouldn't see it? The man revolutionized how we think of fighting and stuff like that, you know?
Definitely.
Let's see. The first ever image to show light as a wave and a particle at the same time. That's pretty cool.
That is really cool.
Oh, here we go. Here's something that we're all interested in. GTA 5 Online Heists update is also adding new free roam activities and new PvP modes.
Yes.
Now, this is something we can talk about a little bit. So, for those of you who don't know, heists are coming out on the 10th, which is next week, next Tuesday. But the update is also bringing with it free roam activities and daily objectives. Daily objectives offer other players a series of challenges they can complete during jobs or free roam for in-game cash. Three objectives will be offered each day, and a potential rewards are substantial. Rockstar says stacking challenges over the course of more than a day can net you more than 500 grand.
Wow. It's pretty good.
So that's a good way to make money in GTA Online, which is honestly what GTA Online has been missing.
That's true. Yeah. And you're gonna need it with heist. Heist costs a lot of money.
Yeah. Free Roam is also being bolstered with new activities, including many of the single-player game's characters. Lester, for instance, will sometimes contact players and request that they distract the police, keeping them away from Lester's criminal colleagues. Other new activities include Lamar asking players to destroy vehicles, or Trevor and Ron asking for help destroying rival planes in the air.
Sounds cool. I'm down.
I'd be perfectly fine helping with Lester's jobs or Lamar's. Taking out a plane in midair is a bit tricky unless you know how to fly a Buzzard or a Apache. The three new PvP modes are interesting, and one is very clearly inspired by Terminator 2, namely the Hasta la Vista.
Don't know why you would thought that.
And he's asleep again.
Oh my goodness. Oh my goodness.
He must be tired. Wake up!
Wake up! Just definitely put like a audio headphone warning.
I'll put an annotation for that. It's like, if you're wearing headphones, you might want to turn the volume down. Okay, moving on. Project Morpheus release window and specs have been revealed. And there was a demo at GDC that put people in a VR shootout. Moving on. We're almost done. An RPG with no wizards or spaceships? Sign me up. This is a pretty cool. As Kingdom Come Deliverance, which is a medieval RPG that's all about history. No monsters, no magic, no witches, no giant rats, just regular folk going about everyday medieval business.
That sounds cool.
Sounds fine with me. Just give me a sword and a shield and I'll be fine.
Right? Are there dragons?
Nope. Just fight everybody, fight regular people. I guess.
Dragons!
Moving on, Shadow of Mordor wins Game of the Year at GDC Awards. So while Dragon Age Inquisition won at DICE, Shadow of Mordor won at GDC. So two different developer conferences, two different games of the year. And the new but very early Unreal Tournament is already really fun. This gets me excited because we haven't seen a new Unreal Tournament in a while. I mean years. I think the last one was around Gears of War time, like when the first Gears of War came out.
Oh wow.
So it's been a while since we've seen a new Unreal Tournament. Okay, last week we talked about New Mexico's spaceport.
Yes.
Now the British government's looking to get in on that hot advertising territory, apparently.
I mean, yeah, if you guys are going to actually use it.
The British government has backed plans to build a UK spaceport.
By all means, I guess.
And we talked about this a little earlier, but Steam Store launches new hardware section, where, as I said, it has the Steam controller, the Steam Play, all the new SteamOS consoles, Steam VR, all already listed, and everything except the Steam VR has been labeled for November 2015 release, with the Steam VR labeled as Holiday 2015 release.
Yeah.
So, look forward to that. The CIA.
Investing in 3D printers that can build electronics. More 3D printers.
Yes. We actually talked about something like this a couple weeks ago, I believe, when we said that there was a 3D printer that was building complex dual-layered circuit boards.
Yeah. So, I mean, I guess that's cool. I feel like every time I see something about the CIA, I'm just like, that's sketch, but I mean, Maybe that's just a social.
Hey, we get their hand-me-down tech, so whatever, right?
Yeah.
High-tech farms where our future food will grow in nothing but air.
This was cool. I mean, okay.
They're basically hydroponic farms, so technically it's air and water, but still, you get the point.
Yeah, and we're basically accommodating our overpopulating world.
Yeah. And unlike most common farms, aeroponic and hydroponic farms can actually grow a multitude of different things as compared to each farm designated, like this farm's growing wheat, this farm's growing corn, and stuff like that. They can instead grow multiple different types and multiple different species of the same plant without it worrying about cross-germination and stuff like that, because it's all a controlled environment.
Yes.
And last but not least, you have the honors.
End of an era, eliminating elephant acts. So the Ringling Brothers, no more elephants, guys.
I'm all for it.
Yeah, I'm all for it too. I really think that other people should also follow,
now that one of the major circuses has stood up for this, I think it's only a matter of time before we see Barnum and Bailey and all the other ones follow suit.
I really hope so. Like, I just, it's sad. It bugs me. So, poor animals.
Yeah. Hashtag Sleepy Beardy.
Oh, now I hear him. I can't hear him until you, like, say it, and then I really pay attention.
Alright.
That's funny.
So, this was a good episode. Barring technical difficulties, of course.
Well, technical difficulties aside, I think it went very well.
Alright, so you want to do your outro?
Yeah, so guys, again, I'm Ashley Archaic. You can find my YouTube channel right above, just search Ashley Archaic. I do, again, Let's Plays, Versus, I do Twitches as well, just whatever I'm playing at the moment. I've been doing a lot of Dying Light, so if you like that game or zombies in general, check that out. Make sure to subscribe and follow.
And yeah, I'm Hanyu, and the sleepy one down there usually teams up with me. You can usually find him and me messing around in our GTA Online Presents series on my channel. And most recently, I restarted a fan favorite series, the LegendCraft series, Season 2 LegendCraft Infinity, using the new Infinity FTB mod pack. And that's pretty much it. So, okay, everyone, that's our show. Thanks for watching this week's Nerd Nation, and your source for all the news you need to know. Remember, we go live every Friday night on Twitch at 9 p.m. Eastern, 6 p.m. Pacific, and if you miss an episode, you can always catch up on past episodes on Saturday on our YouTube channels. Also, be sure to check out our Facebook group. So until then, have a good time and stay nerdy. Yeah, have a good weekend. Hashtag Sleepy Beardy. Definitely.
Oh, I already did it.
Thanks for watching, folks.
Thanks, guys. See you next week.
Yep. Hope you enjoyed the show. Sleepy one.